Welcome, everybody. My name is Melanie. I'm one of the messengers of peace with David's ministry. And I have had nothing to do with organising today, so thank you to those who have. I just heard the prompt a couple of days ago to come on down. So I live in Mudgee. We have a Course in Miracles residential property there. We're pretty much redevoted 100% to awakening. And David just invited me to come up and just share a little about what we're doing there. As with most things around David, nothing is planned or organised. The property just seemed to appear last year. One of our devoted people in our community, Sue, it's her family property, and we're actually blessed to be using it for all the purposes. So we have 1,000 acres, we have a beautiful heritage homestead, and anybody is welcome at any time to come for devotional stays with us and just live with us the way that we live. We really live just following the Holy Spirit in every moment, 24/7, watching our mind, devoted to healing our mind, using all of our relationships for that purpose only. And so people can come and stay with us. We have retreats. We have a silent retreat coming up in April. We have a winter retreat in June, and there's information about those on the table there. We're just so happy to be back in Australia. Most of us have lived overseas for many years. And we just want to extend our love to anyone and everyone who feels to come and join us in any way. So, yeah, there's some information on the table also about we have a virtual Unwind Your Mind group. David's not the latest book, 2 books ago. There's around the globe, people are gathering to study the book together and use it to go into their mind and have expression sessions. So we had that on a Tuesday night at 7 o'clock, and anyone from anywhere can join into that. So, thank you. It's my pleasure just to introduce David. I'm so blessed and excited to have you here. I think it's been about 5 years.
Yeah,
since you've been here and picked me up all those years ago. A few of us, actually, so room for a treat. Thank you.
Thank you. Yes, and Kate's right here too. I was asked, we don't have a flyer yet for the Course in Miracles conference coming up, but that's the first Course in Miracles conference. You want to just come up and share a little bit about, because this is the locals, some of the
yes.
locals.
Yeah. Okay.
That's where we start. We start right with the locals and then we build.
Yes. Thank you everyone for coming here today. Yes, the Course in Miracles conference, we don't have a flyer just yet, but we've only just decided on pricing and venue. But it is on October the 28th to October the 30th this year. And David's committed to coming out, and we've got Gary Renard. And so Gary's going to speak on the Saturday, David's doing the Sunday. So it's a 3-day, on the Friday, it felt like a big prompt for me last year to try to help sort of get everybody that's studying the Course in Miracles or on a spiritual path just together, to come together. And I just asked, you know, how could I be helpful in helping get this sort of coming together? So it was just to ask some spiritual teachers to come out because of the cost of the fees to go over to the, you know, to the States generally. So we only have to pay one fee for them to come out. And we can get these beautiful teachers, and it helps us go deeper, and it keeps us really mindful. So the Friday, the prompt really felt to do like a day of some sort of experiences. We're all coming together, so we're getting to know each other. And then the other 2 days, we can obviously have interactions and listening to course teachers. But it really feels like this real coming together, this joyful, this joining. So that was the prompt, and that's sort of like the idea behind it. And it's all just unfolded beautifully. It's all, everybody sort of said yes, they'd love to come. And so now that we've got a few things organised, we've got a venue that's just beautifully appeared, the right price, and so the ticket pricing is very reasonable. It feels like we'll now be sort of publicising it a bit more. And so you'll see on the website and the Facebook, and Sophie's done a beautiful job, and that's all fallen into place. It's just been beautifully flowing. And so I'm very honoured to hear David speak today and to have been his presence. I picked him up from the airport the other day, so it was just lovely. And so the whole idea behind the conference is sort of joining with your brother, coming closer together with support. So how that comes out, it's not up to me, but it feels like that was my prompt, to just bring something, and then maybe each year it'll bring it in, because we are quite a distance away, even though, you know, the internet, we're all connected quite deeply, but there's nothing like being in the presence of each other, and it seems to bring sort of a bit more of a dynamic to the healing. So anyway, thank you everyone, I really appreciate it. And I'd love to see you there at the conference. So that's October the 28th to 30th. Thank you. Thanks, David.
Thank you, Kate. That's exciting. It's always, we come up with a lot of excuses to come together, but that's a beautiful excuse.
Yeah.
So already I know you've got, I saw your Facebook page, so people can go right home and start tuning into that right away, and then it just keeps going from there. I'm sure there'll be all kinds of flyers. Well, thank you for this warm welcome. It's so good to come here, and I just love being with you, and I love returning here to Australia. I see so many dear, dear friends here, and it's been a while. I think it's been about 5 years or so since I've been here, but it feels just like the same moment. We're still all sharing this beautiful moment together, rejoicing in this moment, and loving it. And I think James had wanted to have maybe a little gathering in the living room, and he said, yeah, let's have a little gathering from 2 to 4 in the living room. And then I think a flyer got made and put out, and then that's why we're here. So
the living room's not this big.
No, it would have been a cozy little fit, but it wouldn't be impossible with this group. But and then, so Tia and James are hosting Sam and I while we're down here in Mornington Peninsula, and these are some of Tia's paintings around here too. So it's a little deja vu, because Tia and I did a similar thing where I was speaking up, I think it was Gold Coast, with Raj and Suze, and there was a nice big space, and Tia had put her paintings up, and I don't know when that was, it was probably in the mid-2005. Okay, so that's amazing that it's come around again, and we're just enjoying every moment. It's just precious to be here with you and to come together in this communion spirit that is so far beyond our perception, it's beyond the body. We feel it, we feel the love rising up in us, we feel it in our hearts. We come together with open hands and open arms. We open our hearts, we open our minds to the Spirit and ask the Spirit to come and move in us and through us, that we may merge with the Spirit that we truly are, that we were created as. And it's quite an undoing. From the ego's perspective, it seems like quite a dismantling and an undoing. And it can have some jagged edges, because the ego wants to exist, even though it's not a creation of Spirit and God, and so it can't really exist. You might say it's living on borrowed time. It invented time, and it's borrowed. And the Course and Jesus are just saying, you know, there's this tiny little speck of a thought in your mind that believes it's possible to be apart from everything, apart from God and love and oneness. And so Jesus is just kind of nudging and saying, it's okay, give it back. You can give it back to eternity. You'll lose nothing in the exchange of this puff of nothingness in exchange for eternity. And yet, the entire belief system that's underneath this linear time-space cosmos is is a belief that there's something more than nirvana, more than heaven, more than everything. And so with this crazy tiny mad idea, this crazy belief, it seems like now it's a sacrifice to go back home. Even though that could be, we could say there's nothing that could be further from the truth. It can't really be a sacrifice to be who you always are and always have been. But from the experience of letting go, and that's what we're going through in this earth experience, it seems like there's a sacrifice demanded of us or asked of us. And it's a strange position when you think of it, to be afraid of love, to be afraid of divine love. It doesn't even make sense, you know, to the mind that seems to be a human being. It's like, no, I want love. I'm not afraid of it. But psychologically, there's such a fear of letting go of the familiar and the comfort of time and space and going into what seems to be the great unknown. So a lot of you know that these gatherings I do, they're just very practical, very simple joinings of coming together and really just allowing whatever comes to the surface to come to the surface. I've always been big on practicalities and practical experience. I think that the Holy Spirit and Jesus have this monumental convincing job, but we've all shown up with our hands up in the air saying, count me in, I'm coming, I'm going through a conversion, I'm going through a transition, but here I come. And we know that there's a lot of strength and love and support behind this call, that we've all been called by God and we're answering the call. And in A Course in Miracles, welcome, come on in, I think we've got, still have some seats here. In A Course in Miracles, Jesus says, all are called, but few choose to listen. So we're all saying, few? Okay, it doesn't matter. It's important. It's important for me to answer the call. It's very, very important. And so we have come into this presence to say yes. We're going to say yes to God. So one of the things that I've just been looking at too is this idea that it can't really be difficult. It can only be that the resistance has to come up into awareness. We have to not hide the resistance. So it's okay to talk about the resistance. It's okay to let everyone know, well, this is what we're doing, and there is still some fear and doubt that's down there, but we're going to face that. We're going to face it head on. We're not going to try to push it down, push it out of awareness. We're not going to try to hide from it. And when we do that, we basically allow ourselves to go through a healing process. Healing in the mind, not just trying to heal the body or heal circumstances and situations. So it's beautiful that you're all here, and I just feel so connected with all of you. I feel some of you I've seen on the internet and felt you, and now I get to be with you, so to speak, in person, and we can just go into this experience together. So I just want to open it up with everyone like we do in all these gatherings, just to see if there's anything, any topics or themes or areas where you've been practicing. One of the recent lessons that I popped into was lesson 133 in the workbook, where Jesus says, it is important to bring the student away from lofty, high ideals into practical experiences and practicality. And he heads off that lesson with that, and then he goes into talking about the conditions of starting to discern the valuable from the valueless. And basically his first condition is, it will not last forever. It has no value whatsoever. That's his first criteria. And then if you choose to take something away from someone, you will have nothing left. So to me, that's a pretty strong teaching, and yet when we start to apply it in our lives, we start to be honest with ourselves and say, is there anything that I'm still invested in the temporal? Anything that if God came knocking and calling today, that I could just say, Lord, can I have a little time, little moment of your time there to help me with something that I'm still thinking about in my mind and still passing through in my awareness that I want to take a close look at with you? And really, that's what we do when we come together. We have the support of the Spirit through each other, through our mighty companions. Or as we say down here in Australia, the mighty mates. We've got very strong mighty mates. It's our version of the Course down here. Are you doing okay? Yes, with my mighty mates, I cannot fail. So let me just open it up after that greeting and say, I love you all, and I'm really open to any kind of topics or questions that you'd like to explore today. Something that's going on in your life maybe that you'd like to talk about or have a little bit of clarity on as we go deeper. Yes?
What would be your reaction to the issue of dealing with exploitation, abuse, criminality as a miracle student?
Well, that is a key point with the Course in Miracles, because whether we talk about abuse, exploitation, or just plain being unfairly treated, whether it's in a personal sense or it's something that we're watching on the news or something that we're even aware of, you know, through a book or maybe even throughout history, all of time and space seems to be filled with many, many opportunities to choose again when we see the idea of exploitation. So for me, exploitation basically rest on the belief that someone or something or some external force can do something to yourself or to your brothers and sisters as you perceive them that is against their will. And we could say that if the will is to be happy, the will is to be peaceful, joyful, to live a loving life, that anything that seems to be a force or an action or an event that is done involving manipulation or control or deceit, everything that goes into exploitation has to be looked at very deeply. So in my own work with the Course in Miracles, I had a lot of different opportunities traveling and going on the road. And somebody was recently reminding me of an experience I had back, I would say it was my second year out on the road working with the Miracles book, and basically going for a walk along the beach and coming back and the car was gone. The car was missing. And no sign of it. And so I do remember a group of lessons that came to me immediately from the Course, because when you start to study this, you pray a lot and you receive these lessons to practice with everyday examples. And one of the things that I got was nothing you need will be denied you, and another lesson was that all things work together for good. There are no exceptions to it. So for me, my work with the Course in Miracles has convinced me that exploitation is a misperception. And it means that no matter what the evidence seems to be in form, and there's lots of evidence, we might say it's like the acronym for fear, false evidence appearing real. There's lots of evidence, but we always have a choice of our interpretation. And the ego belief system is the belief system in victimization, in the belief that you can be acted upon and harmed from forces that are external to your own mind, your own consciousness. And this belief system is teaching us that if you seem to be exploited or you seem to be hurt or injured in some way, The secret of salvation is but this: you are doing this to yourself. Not as a person, not at the level of a person doing it to themselves, but at the level of a consciousness or mind. And therefore, I have to get back into my awareness of that consciousness. I have to get in touch with my mind. I have to get in touch with my thoughts and my beliefs. Because until I get in touch with those thoughts and beliefs, the evidence will continue to roll on like a movie. And there will be lots of perceived exploitation in that movie, as long as my consciousness is still holding on to this belief in victimization. I would say the most fundamental split in terms of consciousness is the idea that there can be a subject and an object, or an observer and observed. There have been many, many great teachers throughout the ages. I call them teachers of truth, or non-dual teachers, and the Course in Miracles is a non-dual system for healing your mind and waking up to spirit. Has anybody ever heard of Sailor Bob? There we go. There's a non-dual teacher, and it's teaching the same ideas, except it's coming from a different terminology than a Course in Miracles, but the same teachings. And so, for me, the practice has been, whenever I feel that I've been unfairly treated, or I perceive that something has been done to me against my will, that's my forgiveness opportunity. And there have been lots of them. But my experience has been, as I've gone through this experience, that has been a thought system that has been rinsed in my mind, to the point where I can see that whatever I am feeling and whatever I am perceiving is a decision in my mind, and it's not happening to me. That everything that's happening is happening for me, and for me to choose again, to choose a higher perspective.
And so what did you do in the car theft situation that relates to that?
Well, when the car was gone, actually before the car was gone, my friend who was driving, and we were traveling in her car, she had said something maybe about an hour before that, just saying something, my car. And I said, well, it's actually the Holy Spirit's car. Jesus can use this car any way that he wants to. Which is good, because there was a little foreshadowing coming in there. So that when the car was gone, and we had just got back from a walk on the beach, her pants were still wet, a little wet from the ocean waves coming up, and we were walking in kind of wet clothes and walking back to the car. And when the car was gone, her eyes were very big. Her mouth dropped open, and I remember these things coming from the Course, just almost like reassuring her that, well, we're on an adventure together, we're on a voyage, we're on a journey together, and this is going to be very interesting. That's what I ended up saying, this is going to be very interesting. So, at that point, we started walking, because there was no car in the parking space. And we walked a ways, and we got picked up by the park rangers, who said, hop in the back of the truck. We got taken there. We did the same things that most people would do when their car was taken. Because it had all of our luggage in, it had all of our money, wallets, purses, everything. All we had was maybe watches and some clothes on our back that we were wearing. And everything else was in the car for, let's say, about a 6-week journey. So even our Course in Miracles books were gone. But the voice had said, nothing you need will be denied you. So we were taken to the ranger station, we made some calls. Things that you would normally do, like if you have credit cards and your wallet's stolen, you just call to report that. We we didn't really have a place to stay. There were people that were, we were going to stay with, and we did have their phone number still in our pocket. So we called them, and basically, while we were there, the people around us were like reflecting some of the thoughts that were still in our awareness, like, oh, that's terrible. You mean you just came down here and it's your first trip to Miami, Florida, and you've lost your car and everything? That's terrible. You know, there was people around us that were reflecting fear, but I think underneath it for me there was an underlying sense of trust, like I'm not here to interpret what's happening, but I'm here to trust that it's all for the healing of my mind. So we continued on, and basically after we made a number of calls, the people that we were going to stay with, who we had not met yet, came and they picked us up. So we had a nice hug, and we said, thank you. Well, this isn't turning out quite the way we thought. We were going to stop for a little walk on the beach before calling you, but here we are. On the way home, the man was involved with the 12-step program, Alcoholics Anonymous. And so he said, would you mind if we stop by this meeting hall for 12 steps? On the way home, we said, listen, we're happy to have a ride and a place to go sleep. So we stopped, and we met the people, lots of hugs again, meeting new friends, which is really what the journey's about, to meet friends and see the love that's in your heart with everyone you meet. And they had a big box in the back that was kind of donations of people, a clothing drive going on. This was Miami, Florida, so we went in there and they said, here, go, you guys need clothes, so that's what maybe this clothing drive is for. So we went through the box and I was getting very nice shirts and belts, pants, finding things that fit me, so was my friend Beverly, and so on and so forth. And by the end, we had little bags that they gave us, little brown bags, we put the clothes in, and Beverly had watched me try on the clothes, and she said, I think the Holy Spirit dresses you better than you dress you. You've just had like a major upgrade in your wardrobe without knowing it. And this is the kind of thing that I'm talking about. When we talk about miracles, if you are willing to hold on to the perspective that everything is happening for you, not to you, but for you, then you start to relax. And first we had the clothes come, then we were taken there, we went to a course meeting. The only thing in that car that we had borrowed for the trip was a tent, so it really wasn't ours. And we were planning to do some camping on that trip, so we went to a course meeting. But before we went to the course meeting, our friends took us to an outdoor store for camping and so on and so forth. They had a used tent, and it was, how much money it was, but I do remember he told us how much a used tent would be. We went to the course group. At the end of the course group, the facilitator said, well, these people just lost their car, and they're brand new in town and everything, and we usually pass around a basket just for some donations to help run the meeting, but if anybody wants to contribute to them, the money that we got was the exact amount that the tent would cost. So we knew that that was to go get the tent. And eventually, over the course of like a weekend, I think this was all over a weekend, so like Friday, by Monday morning, we did get a call that they had found the car, and the car had been stripped. Apparently in port cities around the United States, that's a common thing where people take cars, they strip them, and they take things from them. And so we went there on Monday morning. We had to wait till Monday morning. We went there. The car was there. Everything pretty much was taken out of the car. The steering column, the plastic around it was ripped out, so you could, a little bit of Star Wars, R2-D2, some of these robots. It was wires, a lot of wires. But the car still ran, and the only thing that was left in the back seat was was two worn-out Course in Miracles books. And my friend reminded me that I had said, nothing you need will be denied. So we had a stripped-down car that still drove. It needed a little bit of repair. We didn't do cosmetic repairs. We left the wires hanging and just got it to run. We had our course books, and we ended up going up the other side of Florida, stopping at Unity churches, Course in Miracles meetings, and still continuing on with our trip and sharing the experience that everything had actually been provided to us that we needed to continue on, including the course books, the worn-out course books. Like the Spirit was like saying, you are far from finished with your forgiveness lessons. You're just starting. And that was literally in 1992, so that was, yeah, that was probably 20, 25, 24 years ago. So it has continued on. That was one of the events that happened. There were lots that happened to me over the years. But I have to say that that calmness, that trust on the inside of my heart has stayed there regardless of the people I've met or the situations that seem to come to me. There were some situations that I would call emergency situations, and Jesus even uses the word that there will be situations that are like emergency situations where you'll need your mind training, you'll need your trust like a torch to carry you through those difficult situations. They aren't really difficult, it's really that the ego's interpretation of the situation is very fearful, which makes it like a threat. But it's just another opportunity to trust and to be carried through and to go deeper and deeper into it. So that was one of the early experiences, and I have to say that I look back on those early years with the Course and particularly those first 5 years from 1991 to 1996. Those were years always on the road. That particular trip I had a tent, but a lot of times I had no tent. I was either taken in at course groups or taken in different places, and so I traveled around for about 5 years with no house and no travel trailer, or you know, oftentimes without even a tent, and I was taken in over and over and over in many situations, almost a little bit like traveling troubadour or gypsy or something. But I could see that the reason I went through those experiences while I was working with A Course in Miracles was to build my trust that I would be taken care of without the things that I call past learning, because this was a very different lifestyle than I had ever tried. So those particular 5 years were like, I would say, building trust that I could follow and I could learn to follow my intuition, and I would be guided and I would be provided for in every seeming circumstance. And also I would say those were really important years to transcend this belief in victimization. Most people would say that having your car taken, it could be described as thievery or a stolen car, but that's an interpretation that's still coming from the ego. There was years later, years passed, and I had a center, like a retreat center, and it was in rural Kentucky, and I would pick up groups of people at the airport and I would take them down there, and at the end of the road where I had this little house or retreat center, there was an ex-Marine who had spray painted on his barn in big letters, "All thieves must die." It's kind of interesting that years later that I had a retreat center, and every time I would pick people from the airport up, there was this rickety old fence, and they're all Course in Miracles students, and then I'd come by, and I would try to zip by it, but every time I'd go by it, it's on the road, they would go, "And what's the meaning of that? All thieves must die." And so one time we were driving by and they said, what's the spiritual significance of that? All thieves must die. And I said, well, it's ex, you know, Marine and he's spray painted. But what came out of my mouth was, in the Bible, it says the wages of sin is death. And what I interpreted that to mean is, you know, if you believe in sin, you believe in death. And if you believe in thievery, if you believe that something can be stolen, actually stolen, then you believe in death too. It's not part of the spiritual high perspective that all things are working together for good. And the Spirit will seem to arrange and rearrange things all the time. You know, Jesus even says, if you'll be a miracle worker for me, I will arrange time and space for you. Sometimes the ego doesn't like the way that arrangement happens. If you think you own something and it's gone, like that car, you know, it's a stretch. The ego's like, so now that's just plain old robbery. That's what that is. But in this higher perspective, you do have this sense that you're cared for, and it's all part of lessons that you're learning, and you're learning how to heal and forgive. And so from that higher perspective, it's quite miraculous, it's quite amazing. So that's just an example of a practical example of how I would say when we open up to the Holy Spirit and we say, please use my life, use my dream, use my daily situations for healing, that it's very practical. And that was a good example of what happened when I did the workbook lessons, because every day I was doing the workbook lessons, I had circumstances and situations that related directly to the lesson, as if, synchronistically, the day was being completely arranged for me to get my lesson. And that's a whole different perspective than we're used to as well. We're used to thinking of the day just goes as the day goes, and as if the day is at random, but nothing in this world is at random. It's all used. So thank you for that question, because that's definitely a key point, that as long as we have this belief that we can be mistreated, victimized, unfairly treated in any way, then we have definitely some healing to do. Okay, anyone else? Yes.
I was just wondering if you can talk about facing your fears.
Yes, I think that facing fears is something that it takes a lot of willingness and it takes a lot of courage, because this world is like the projection of fear. And so for most human beings, there are fearful opportunities. You know, there's a feeling of fear in the mind with a lot of different things that happen on a daily and a weekly basis. And for me, it's been something that I've had to really give myself over to, because I felt like when I opened up for healing, I said, I'm willing to face whatever darkness is in my mind. Whatever unconscious darkness is still there, it's pushed out of awareness, then there's been like releases of fear over and over and over. And this was a process that began actually before I started studying A Course in Miracles. I started to have these huge swells of emotions coming up, and I had a lot of tears, and I faced depression and a lot of human emotions, and yet I felt there was something important happening in just allowing myself to feel whatever was arising in awareness. And then when I got into A Course in Miracles, it was as if I would get periodic pep talks of saying, yes, you will have to face darkness, and we must go through the darkness to the light. So this is not a path of just trying to affirm the light. It's actually facing the darkness and facing the fears. So when I first got into the course, and I first was involved let's say for some time I was just reading the book and praying and meditating and working with the book, but then through my relationships, I noticed right away with my girlfriend back in the 1980s that there was an enormous amount of fear that started to come up in the context of the relationship. And it was so strong that I was startled and I was shocked at the intensity of the darkness. I just thought, wow, I am not prepared for that much intensity. In fact, it got to be so intense that I felt I didn't understand how people could hold down jobs, have relationships, how they could go to school, how they could function as human beings with the severity of the darkness that was underneath there. You know, it just was shocking when it came up into awareness. And so there were different ways that the Spirit helped me with that. One of them was going off and doing like these little hermitages out in nature. Like I would say, a lot of mystics and saints, if you read the literature on the saints and the Dark Night of the Soul, St. John of the Cross, and things, you can see that they're going through huge intensities. But I did give myself time to kind of go away and face it. Because I thought, I don't think I want people around me when this darkness is coming up. I'm going to be screaming and spitting nails when this is going to happen. So I'm going to have to face whatever this is and the depth of it. And those hermitages were very helpful. I also noticed over the years that Jesus guided me to kind of out-of-the-way places where there just were not a lot of people around. And even this monastery, this Course in Miracles monastery that we've formed in Utah, it's in the canyon, so you know you're just surrounded by a lot of rocks. And rocks are really good mighty mates when you have rage coming up. The rocks can handle the rage. You know, you can rage and rage and rage at these rocks, and the rocks are like, no big deal. No problem. No straitjackets, no drugs, no Thorazine or anything pumped into your veins, no people grabbing at you, you know, the rocks can handle it. In fact, I've heard you've got a big rock here called Ayers Rock, so if anybody is going through the rage, get a plane ticket, go out to Ayers Rock and let it have it, you know, give it all your rage. It can handle it. And I think that's why a lot of the mystics, if you go all the way back to Buddha, Jesus went off and prayed on the mount. Many, many mystics have gone out into nature. There are many nature mystics because you don't quite draw the same reflections from the trees and the rocks that you do from people around you who would say you're going crazy and you need to be locked up and drugged. Which is important because we do have to move through the darkness. So I would say that that's been a big part of my journey, has been allowing the fear to come up and facing it. Even when there was a temptation to project the cause of it onto a person, a situation, an event, project it onto history, you know, there's so much, that's what the whole world is like, a projection and almost like a dumping ground. It's an opportunity for scapegoating and projecting the cause away from your consciousness and away from your mind onto something in form. And soon you learn that that's the trick of the ego. Blaming is how you keep it. And forgiving and releasing is how you're free of it. And everyone has to face that rage. It's just great that I feel like that we have a plan now that involves so many helpers that when you're going through this intense rage, that there are those that can hold the space for you, that can be there for you, that can love you through it, that can not judge you while you're going through it. And it's very different from my journey, which was, I think, many years of like solitary kind of trying, I'll do it on my own. I'll face this all on my own. And it was tough. I think it was tough and it was longer. And if I had been open to the experience of the mighty mates, I think it would have gone much faster. Because when you have witnesses that won't join you in the rage, but have great allowance and love and respect, and maybe have gone through it themselves, so they're like, been there, I know you need me here, I'm here for you no matter what, and you know, you have full permission to go through and spit it out, cough it up and spit it out. That's beautiful. So I would encourage that. That's really why we're here for each other. We're here to provide that spaciousness, that love, that acceptance for this darkness to move through. And it's been buried and hidden for millennium, so we do have to take it easy on ourselves. We should not be quick to conclude something about the darkness in us. We should be very patient and willing to let it move through and let the love that's even deeper than the darkness come and shine through. Thank you. Yes?
I have two sons with a lot of difficulties. I prayed last year for help, and I was guided to pick up the Course in Miracles. Since I've done that, I feel more at peace with what's going on for them. But I still wonder if there's more I could do or not do. One has anxiety, depression, autism, and doesn't leave the house and is anxious. The other one has other problems where he doesn't believe in himself and he's meeting the wrong people and doing things that are not good for him. I have let go and put him in the hands of the Holy Spirit, and I'm a lot more peaceful about it, but it's hard to still watch what they're doing to themselves and not wanting to change them. Is there any advice you can give for me on that? Or do I just watch them and let go? Probably that's the answer, right?
But I think you're aware that's the direction you're moving in. It's the temptation to fix people, change people, or correct people, and so forth, is a very deeply ingrained belief. And it's almost like underneath that belief that we're supposed to fix them, change them, correct them, we may even say, we may do it under the guise of, well, I need to help them. And oftentimes, what's underneath helping them is saving them. Somehow, that we're seeing ourselves as some kind of a personal savior for these important figures. I mean, when you look at it in terms of the world, you know, you could say, well, out of 7 billion human beings, these two particular characters have more of an importance than the other 7 billion. Because you probably see a lot of things going on the news and the newspaper and everything, and the same kind of things going on, but these two are really grabbing your attention. And if you follow the root of the discontent or the root of the conflict down, you will see you'll start to tap down into some duty and responsibility beliefs. So A Course in Miracles is a teaching saying your sole responsibility, your only responsibility, is to accept the correction in your mind for this error called ego. But there's this crazy belief in separation from God, and your responsibility is to accept the correction, period. And the ego is like saying, well, yeah, that's not going to work here because you have some important other responsibilities. But actually, when we come down to it, our peace of mind is not a small matter, and it's really for the whole universe. So you're doing this cleanse, this purification for the whole universe. In the end, there's only one of us, and this belief that we're separate people with separate identities, separate minds, separate thoughts, it's all part of a vast construct to keep us guilty. And when there's conflict, there's guilt. There's still guilt in the mind. So it's not like you try to be some kind of a stoic, okay, I'm just not going to do anything for anyone. It's more that you become prayerful and you look at your motivations, and when you start to feel that love and that compassion welling up in you, and you get guidance to offer something, say something, extend something, it comes from that place of peace and from strength. It doesn't come from worry or concern or fear, doubt, conflict. It comes from that peace. And that is the direction. Sometimes there's programs in the world, they call it tough love, and all they mean by tough love is stay aligned with what's real and true. And even if the reactions can sometimes be very sharp to that, because you're literally pulling your mind away from, you know, people-pleasing and caretaking and codependency and all these ego dynamics, you're staying true to that. But you really have to just honestly watch your feelings and just see that when you do act or you do say anything, if you're guided to do that, it's coming from that place of peace. And it's a very direct pathway to God when you're in a situation where you have been caring for and helping it as best you can, and you just want the peace of mind now. And you're asked to stay true to that. Stay true to your feelings, stay true to that peace, and be carried through it. So you're on the right track. I think you know.
I feel it. I do feel it.
Yeah.
I just wondered, because I'm still fairly new at studying the course.
Mm-hmm.
So I just, but I do feel a whole difference since I've been studying it and practicing it, not just with my sons, but in my life. It's wonderful.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's it. The blessing is in practicing it.
Yeah.
You are convinced through the practice.
Yeah.
Yes.
Thank you.
Anyone else? Yes.
I started A Course in Miracles this year, and I've had a very long spiritual practice of all sorts of things, but I really felt moved to do it, and it's very synchronistic. Of course, most of us would say that, how it falls into your life. But it's funny you told a story about a car, because when I started it, all these things have started happening to me. So, for instance, I was driving in my car with my son up the Calder Freeway, which people would know, in the left-hand lane, minding our own business, and somebody hit our car at 120 kilometres per hour on the left-hand side of our car in the left lane, so I don't even know how that was possible. Like, I don't know if I didn't see it coming at. And the car started spinning out of control, and something came alive in me, and I pulled the car up, and the person pissed off. And he wrote off our car. I had no money, hardly any money, which meant that we didn't have a car for this long period of time. We'd live in the country. It was really inconvenient, actually, but I kept going, well, you know, I believe the universe is friendly. I believe this is for us, you know. And like you said, people around me were saying, what a bastard, you know, how could he do that to you? And I felt I felt that alive in me too, that sense of, yeah, you know, righteousness, how could somebody. And I was shocked that somebody could do that, that they could actually do that. But on a cosmic level, I had to keep going, well, it happened. That's reality. That's what happened. And he did what he believed was right for him, because maybe he was on drugs or drinking, or who knows, whatever. But that's what happened. But then all these other things happened, and I finally got a new car, and then the new car completely clapped out, and I paid all this money, and I found myself in the most enormous amount of debt, you know. And I said, this year for me was the year that I would clear my debt, and in fact I've created more debt. And I am in a huge amount of debt, and I've made very bad, choices that weren't particularly serving me, or they were serving something in me. However, here I am with this, whacking amount of debt, and I work as a holistic coach, and I'm running a program helping other people to study A Course in Miracles, and but I'm so, I have really no money, and last year I stopped work, and I trusted, and I really lived in trust, and we didn't have any money, and we had all this debt, but we kept kind of living, and there was enough money just sometimes to, put food on the table, but things fell off the wagon, of course, so bank debt got bigger, etc., etc. But I guess for me, I don't really know what this lesson about being in, because in every other way my life is so abundant, and I feel so full of gratitude, and I love the people in my life, and I just love life so much, and I have these experiences where there's so much synchronicity, and there's all this kind of just incredible blessing, really incredible blessing. This one area, and I work with it from a different perspective. I do the work on it. I know money is empty. It's just a, a piece of paper or plastic, and it's what I make it mean. And I can know that, but I'm still got, creditors ringing me up, the bank saying you haven't paid your mortgage this month, and there's no work, and I'm trusting going, I'm going to run workshops, and I've developed this course, and I'm actually really good at what I do. But there's something going on, and I'm doing the course daily through the workbook and finding it so profound, so deeply profound. I feel like it's, such an incredible teacher. But I don't know what to do with this.
Yeah. I'm glad you're bringing it up, because when we talk about this unconscious sense of guilt and fear, or the sense of lack, because debt and lack are very related. We can see that it's like this deep, like a vein of darkness. It's in tied in with the debt and the lack. There's a sense of unworthiness relating towards love, and it's somewhere you've prayed the prayer in your heart, like I want to be free of this. I want to heal of this. I want to. And that's what life coaching is about, is coming. I want to come back to be fully alive,
yes.
Vibrant,
yes.
Happy,
yes.
Feeling of ease, feeling of abundance,
yes.
Not a feeling of scarcity or lack whatsoever.
Yes.
And in doing this work for over 25 years, I encountered it in myself. When I first got into A Course in Miracles, I had student loans, which is a form of debt as well, and that was something that was right in front of me, like right in my face. And when you start A Course in Miracles, I've heard so many stories very similar to what you're saying, where you feel it, it drops into your life through various circumstances, and then it's almost like somewhere deep in your mind you've made a promise or a contract, or you've offered and said, okay, it's time to heal. I'm going to go through whatever I need to go through for this healing. It seems, from the ego's perspective, to be very extreme, because it's like this thing, like a very dark cloud that's like hanging over you, where many aspects of your life, you can just feel the gratitude swirling and flowing, and then there's this black cloud that's like hanging over there.
And it's actually gotten worse this year. Like last year, I earned no money, but I did the work of Byron Katie a lot. And I just was at peace with having, because I could see I had everything I needed, and I did a big hermitage too in nature, and I came back feeling completely seeing I have everything I need. But something has suddenly switched in over, and you're right, it is like a dark cloud.
Yeah. Well, when in the past, when people have gone off on, we'll say, hermitages, or the 40 days in the wilderness that Jesus went through, or people going off, we'll say, to convents and monasteries and going through pretty much of emotional stripping away of their sense of self as it relates to this world. And with you and with your child and the way things are happening, instead of going off to Vipassana retreats that you've done, instead of, we'll just say, like a 4 or 5 year Vipassana, that you're, you know, maybe you've even got a faster track to God. Your heart is calling out, I'm coming. Okay, we're going to do the mom, the children, the death thing. You know, it's like, because it's intense. Having gone through Vipassana, you can, you know, that intensity, that just the intensity of what seems to be your daily life, it's part of a celestial speed-up. I've been blessed to have gone through it and met so many people who sometimes, who had accumulated debts in kind of strange ways that it kind of came in ways I didn't even foresee. And it was quick, it was rapid, and it was going against what they were conscious of, because consciously they were going to have this be a year of freeing themselves, and all of a sudden now they're facing like a mountain where they thought they just had a little hill to climb. It's like a mountain. But the beautiful thing I think of this path is the support. Is there are so many things. I know, Bo, you had a time too where you were feeling guided even with community, with children. It was like a burning calling that came in. And I think that's, in one sense, we are opening into this era instead of like going stoically and trying to handle this all on our own. We are letting it come up, come out. We're being more transparent than ever. We're being more opening and more welcoming, really, to God and the universe, saying, okay, this is a steep path, and I call for this, and I ask for this, but I want to be open to all the help that can come my way. Because, to me, that's the biggest prayer of the heart, is being open to the symbols of help, so that we have this feeling like we're not alone. It's interesting, I was staying with Mirabella and Maddie, Maddie and Sam were talking at the kitchen table about the suicides, the high rate of suicides for young men in Australia, how high the rate is. And suicide is a topic in an area where you can see that sense of being overwhelmed, overloaded, confused, depressed, maybe extremely depressed. I would say suicide is a symbol of losing hope of paying the bills, losing hope of being able to make it through the next day, losing hope. You can feel that intensity that's coming up from the circumstances, and it's coming up in the mind, it's coming up in consciousness, even though it seems to involve these circumstances. They're more the projection of it. And so it's like you might say, in this lifetime, so to speak, you have just come to a firm declaration in your mind, which is basically saying, enough is enough. I'm not going to run from this form. I'm not going to try to fix the form. I'm going to face the darkness in consciousness. And you're doing it, like a lot of people, as the backdrop of a mother with a child, too. Not off, you know, kind of white-knuckling it in some cave in the Middle East, but, you know, it's just looking very contemplative in the modern-day world where you're facing this. But I think the call I'm hearing is this is the call to join. And I know in my lifetime, I've just witnessed so many miracles where there's been these collaborations of, I don't need to do this on my own. I have brothers and sisters that are with me. They want to join. They see the value of joining in that. even in situations where there's been deaths or there's been some extreme, seemingly physical conditions and what seem to be symptoms and so on and so forth, there's a amazing miracles that are coming from the joining of putting it out there and saying, I want to join, I want to connect, I am open to help. And that's really what I hear is in your question.
Yes.
That, and that would be the ultimate of life coaching as well, to live that way. Very much like when I come to Australia, I always think of the Aboriginals when I'm down here, and the connectivity they had in their tribe. You know, like I think Hillary Clinton one time said, it takes a village to raise a child. There's a wisdom in that openness of saying, I'm open to help, I'm open to collaborate. I want to see the lessons every day, in every moment, and I don't want to be weighed down by this heavy cloud. Because the ego is a death wish, and that's where the suicides come in. It's just when the mind loses all hope of a solution, then the ego feels like it's won, you know. But death is not a release. So Jesus says the ego will pursue you beyond the grave. That's why we have to heal this. We're not going to get any relief through death in any way. So thank you. Thank you for sharing that. And thank you for coming.
Thank you. Yeah. I went to Torquay last night. I live in Castlemaine. I drove to Torquay last night to spend some time with a good friend, and then I drove here, and now I have to drive home to Castlemaine. So I've driven about 700 kilometres last night to see you.
Thank you.
To see me,
see,
really.
Right. For us to join and be lifted up together. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yes.
Thanks.
Thank you. I'm very touched. You have great determination. That's what's very important. Yeah. Yes.
Hi,
there, Sonia. What's your name? She lives in Castlemaine.
Oh, you're Kate.
And Kate lives in
Tewton. I live near Castlemaine too.
Oh, really? Oh, that's
here we go. Now we're seeing it in action. Yeah. You know how it feels when you join like that.
Yeah.
It's almost like, I hear you, I'm with you, you know. And that's why support groups have been so helpful to us all, because we do need support. And it goes the other way of trying to hold it on and hold on to the pride of doing it yourself, kind of digging yourself out. No, you don't have to think like that anymore. And that's beautiful. And you can connect after the program here.
Yeah. I did want to ask, I was just wondering about intimacy, because I've sort of got to a point where I'm really seeing that intimacy isn't about, you know, out there with another, physicality of it. So I just wanted to ask you what you see as true intimacy and how you actually experience that for yourself.
Yeah, I would say that my experience of intimacy is when you start to equate intimacy with transparency, you are on the way to depths of intimacy beyond anything that you've ever experienced. There's an ease that comes in with transparency, where you're taking a leap of faith and trust and saying, I can let whatever needs to move through, and I'm trusting that I won't hold it against myself, my brothers and sisters won't hold it against me, and the universe is not going to hold it against me. That it's the bottling up, and it's the hiding and protecting of thoughts and beliefs that blocks the intimacy. So it's the transparency, it's the authenticity. It's the mind training of A Course in Miracles that takes you go through these workbook lessons, and all of a sudden you hit this repeat lesson, my mind holds only what I think with God. Wow! To come to a state of mind where you start to open up to actually feel the love of my mind holds only what I think with God, everything that takes you in that direction will take you into this soaring sense of intimacy. And it is a washing away of old ideas of intimacy, because it's those old ideas and thoughts and beliefs that keep it hidden from awareness. So there's a lot of focus placed on the body and the ego system. There's also a lot of focus placed on even words. It's not so much the words that we speak that communicate, but it's where are we coming from. Like Jesus has a whole workbook lesson where he talks about a telephone. And he says, in this world, a telephone is for reaching someone who's not in your proximity. He says, the real question you should ask yourself is, what do I want to reach him for? In other words, he's even going beyond the use of devices and words to saying, what's the purpose underneath? And we need to be really honest with ourselves in that, where am I really coming from here? If I'm feeling upset or conflicted and I'm using words to like reinforce that or even try to dig myself out of something with the words, it usually is very complicated and there's not a good feeling with it after the words are shared. But if I'm just coming to that place of transparency where I can just openly share, that's why I've supported those guidelines, no private thoughts and no people pleasing, just as of moving in the direction of openness, of having a complete open mind. So we have to practice also with where the mind's at. We've been talking recently about Skype and Skype calls and how that can seem to be like a digital way of connecting and communicating that can be different than being there face to face. And we were even sharing at the beginning of this gathering, it's like with many of you I've communicated with in various ways, whether it's through mind and thought or through words and things, but there's something beautiful about being together in presence together. As we go deeper into this sense of true intimacy, I think it does seem more and more just like a state of mind and a real connected state of mind and less dependent on any kind of form. But we do have to be very practical. We can't try to jump from A to Z. We have to just say, show me the way. I read a post from Kate, I think you just put it out maybe today or yesterday, but it was all about following the guidance. She had basically the way you live, which was starting off with following the guidance. How I feel and following the guidance, yes, is right at the top. And then letting go of all the other constructs, I think it was in relationship to spiritual teachers and so on and so forth, which really are just more concepts. And the whole journey of authentic awakening is emptying your mind of all the concepts. Just having a still, open, empty mind where the light can just shine through as you, you know, as who you are. And the biggest holdback, the biggest block, I think, to being happy, joyful, loving, friendly, respectful, you know, to being in spirit, is this idea of just getting caught in a role or some kind of a concept and thinking, even spiritual concepts, you know, you start to think, well, okay, most of my spiritual concepts have to go. In fact, I'd say there's only one left for us called forgiveness. That's the only concept that's helpful. And that's an all-inclusive concept where there's no judgment of anything whatsoever. But everything else, you know, is part of our letting go. So to me, that's where the true intimacy comes in, when you can just let go and stay in that, I do not know what anything is for, state of mind. That's the most precious state of mind we can live in. I would say clueless, carefree, and cared for. That's the best. Yes?
How is child abuse different?
Well, child abuse would fit in when we talk about what you perceive in the world comes from what you believe. So everything that we perceive in the world that is we see as horrific, and child abuse would be part of it, would be coming from and generating from a belief system, this ego belief system. And there's certainly a lot of guilt and shame and terror that's tied up in child abuse. Recently, Holy Spirit and Jesus took me to the movies again, and I went to the movie called Spotlight. Has anybody ever seen Spotlight? It's an investigative reporting movie. I think Rachel McAdams is in it, and it's like a newspaper, the Boston Globe, and then they have a branch of these maybe 5-6 people that are part of the Spotlight team that do investigative reporting. And what the whole movie is uncovering all of the child abuse that's been going on for decades in the Boston area with the Catholic Church and the priest with the young boys and the pedophiles. I mean, you know, it goes fully, the whole movie is just an expose of uncovering this massive systematic child abuse that not only seemed to be happening through generations, but also it was covered with reassigning priests around, and it was like a massive cover system. But as I was watching the movie, as I watch any movie, you know, I always come back to, I can't perceive the abuse unless I believe the abuse. I can't perceive the conflict and the split and the fragmentation and all of the horrors of separation unless I believe it in my mind. And so I think watching movies and watching the news and anything that's guided as part of your plan that helps get in touch with those feelings, the wounded feelings that are involved with abuse, is part of the healing of the mind. So whether it's child abuse, or whether it's Nazi Germany, whether it's something that happened decades ago or centuries ago in history, or what they're calling with like ISIS nowadays over in the Middle East and Syria, and genocide with refugees and with particularly women and children and so forth on a massive kind of scale, or Nazi Germany or whatever, it doesn't matter the degree or the size of the perception, it's more, can I get down to the root of this belief in mistreatment? Because what we're learning from A Course in Miracles is that innocence and guilt cannot coexist. If there's any guilt whatsoever, then innocence is gone. There's no sense of innocence. That we have criminal justice systems, we have prisons, we have penal codes, we have all kinds of corrective procedures that all are part of the projection. So we have the innocent victims, and then we have the criminals, the guilty ones. We have the abusers and those that are abused. We have the victims, we have the victimizers. And this entire cosmos that's been going on for all of history, is part of this big trick to keep the mind guilty and unaware of divine innocence. And what we're really learning from the Master, from the way-shower Jesus, is that you cannot hold on to any sense of guilt for yourself or anyone and know the true divine innocence of who you are. He's just saying it's absolutely impossible. And he's also telling us that your will is to know your divine innocence. As I'm speaking to you, I see Tia's painting right behind you, and it's just like this blazing light rising up above the water with all these swirly colors and the purples and everything, and that blazing light is like this it's pure innocence that's above and beyond everything that human beings are addicted to, are trapped in, that we're locked into. So I would say it takes a lot of practice, but if that is an issue to you that's very important, it really gets your attention, it weighs on your mind, it's heavy, then that will be the very kind of issue that the Spirit works with you on to free your mind. It will take the very thing that's heaviest in your mind, and it will keep cleansing it and purifying it and lifting your mind and lifting to reach that transcendent point of going beyond that. That same trip where the car was stolen, seemingly, or the rearrangement of the car symbol, that same trip when I came with my friend Beverly up to Northern California, somebody gave us a flyer, and on the flyer it said, Course in Miracles Hypnotherapist. And I always like when you put Course in Miracles with whatever after, it's always fun. Numerologist, hypnotherapist, Course in Miracles Tarot reader, you know, it always gets my attention. What's that? And my friend Beverly said, I think I'm supposed to see this Course in Miracles hypnotherapist. So I dropped her off, and she was traveling with me. We were having all these daily miracles, but she was hypnotized by this man. And during the hypnosis, these repressed child abuse memories from when she was a little girl came into awareness. And so after I picked her up, she said it was amazing. She said, I was in this real mystical kind of state, and then I got hypnotized, and these abuse memories of being abused by my father came into awareness, but she said, I was so peaceful, I could watch them all as they came into awareness. I wasn't traumatized by the memories. I said, well, that's why you went to a Course in Miracles hypnotherapist, because you were called into the miracle, and that's what the miracle does. It allows you to see the world, to see the memories from a lifted up state of mind. And so you were not traumatized by those. And she said, yeah, it felt really healing. Like I gave myself permission to view again what I was too horrific to even view, and I had kept repressed. She felt lighter, actually, from the whole session. And that's what the mind training of A Course in Miracles is doing. And it happens sometimes through therapists, it happens through many, many different ways. Either past life regressions and all kinds of things that are just tools and symbols that the Spirit is using to free our mind from this deep buried shame and hurt and guilt. And watching that movie Spotlight I felt there was a lot of healing that happened, because once the story broke and they published the findings of the investigation in the Boston Globe, they thought there would be all these church protests that would come, but nobody from the church came to protest. All they did was they had a hotline with people who felt that they had been abused. The phone just kept ringing and ringing and ringing. They just took the lid off of a major mind cover-up and gave permission for so many people to call in and say, let me tell you what happened to me, and I'm so glad I can talk about this, because it's been driving me nuts for years, but nobody seemed to listen, nobody seemed to be there to listen, to let me speak it. And that was the first step, I think, in a lot of healing. And recently we have political elections going on over in the United States, and we have different candidates, and there's this one candidate named Donald Trump, and people have been talking to me and saying they have all kinds of reactions, and finally I saw They asked Deepak Chopra, what do you think about Donald Trump? He said, oh, very good. This is very good for the healing of the unconscious mind. He is acting out so many unconscious thoughts, and this is wonderful for healing. And the interviewer said, well, maybe so, but I don't want to vote for the guy. I tell you that much. And he said, no, we must leave that to the collective choice. You know, it was totally... we shall see what happens with the collective choice. In other words, it was such a broad, sweeping perspective that he had nothing negative to say. He was overjoyed at all the healing that was occurring from this one man acting out all these unconscious beliefs. Now, that's a different perspective than we could say the mainstream perspective is. And I say we could extend it even to issues like child abuse or genocide, that when we look at what's happening in Syria, for example, and the refugees flooding out into all the different countries, when we look at what happens with, you know, people being decapitated, you know, heads chopped off in public squares, raping women, torturing children, and all the different things that seem to go on, the only way you can look at it in a meaningful way that helps you heal is to start to say, wow, this buried unconscious, this darkness of believing we could separate from our source, we have spent millennium trying to stuff it down and run away from it, and now it's getting acted out in what seems to be broader and broader scales. Some people have been saying to me recently, they said, the world is getting really wacky. Just the intensity of what they're watching on the news, it just seems to get wackier and wackier and crazier. Also, you know, like it seems to be wherever I go, instead of just bringing the warmth and the sunshine, I bring the storms. So I came down to Mornington Peninsula, and it was like going to sleep, and it was like howling, pelting rain, howling, pounding, pounding. It's like, thank you, David. you know, we have the wacky weather already here, but we're talking about pounding rain, pelting rain, and high winds. You know, that's kind of the way that it's happened. As I've done these gatherings for these years, sometimes I bring storms, sometimes I remember I would go and I would do this gathering in Georgia, and every time I would visit these people, they would see me the next day, the first day of the retreat, and they would smile and they'd go, you did it again. It's either the plumbing's clogged when you come, or the weather goes crazy. And I went through it for like 5 or 6 years. They said, every time you show up, one time I brought like freezing Arctic blasts from the north down. I was in Florida, and the pipes were freezing and breaking. They go, we don't ever have breaking pipes, but you come here and this Arctic weather comes down from the north and it's breaking pipes. It's just stirring things up. In other words, let's look at this buried, dark guilt and shame, and let's heal it forever. It's time for us to wake up. We want to be lifted up.
Yeah, I was thinking, there was a section, there was a part of when Helen was channeling the course, where, if I don't remember exactly what the term was, but it was like Jesus was saying something to her around, you know, the world really needs this. You know, it's in, you know, not in good shape. And I, the other day when I was talking to you, and you said sort of, you know, you said when you started doing the course, you felt Jesus talking to you quite clearly. I just had, I went away and I felt that you were sort of, I felt this sense, even though you hadn't said it to me, that was coming through for you too, like, because you said, like, I felt this great sense of, like, Jesus asking me to go out and talk to people, and I felt that was sort of, like, it's turning around, you know, through you, through everybody, like, all the people that are affected by what you say, and then we're all having the miracles, and then all the miracles are happening, you know, by each mind waking up, and I just sort of felt, is that what you felt when you were
you know, when Jesus was speaking to you, and I know still, you know, the Holy Spirit and Jesus are very clear for you. Is that what you feel, that this is sort of the going out and talking and really making a difference in the world?
Yeah, it is a feeling of I know Marianne Williamson said one time, she said, we have to start bringing some of these discussions into the mainstream and not covering over things. Like, really talk about it. Let's say it straight. And so, you know, having been raised Christian and gone to Bible school and this and this and this, and then, you know, to go out and be speaking in public and start sharing ideas that God didn't create this world, you know, it's like, well, any Christian who's read Genesis, you know, knows that's like the basic foundations of Genesis. You know, God created the heavens and the earth, and on the seventh day he rested. And then that's coming through. Or talking about pain. I think recently I saw one of the YouTube videos go up, you know, if God is real, there is no pain. If pain is real, there is no God. You know, saying that in public, you know, it's like, whoa. But actually, it's time. It's time for us to awaken from this slumber, from this dream. It does feel like it's like that movie Inception, that the mind has been so asleep that there's layers of sleep, so many layers that the mind has forgotten it's asleep and dreaming. And it's taken now everything to be actualities instead of just dream symbols. So recently I was having lunch with Judy Scutch, who's the publisher of the course, and we were sitting around a table talking, and then she was saying, pointing over towards me, saying, he's like a prophet, a modern day prophet. But when I think of the prophets, I think of the Bible, you know, Isaiah and Ezekiel, and you think of John the Baptist, you know, going around. The one that baptized Jesus, you know, he's going around. Imagine going around Australia. Repent! Repent! There you go. Oh, mate, you need some help. You know, but we're doing our own version of it when we start to sparkle and shine, when we start to bring light and love. That's our way of now, many, many centuries later, saying, turn from the darkness, turn toward the light, turn toward the joy, turn toward the happiness. Our demonstration is sending like ripples throughout the mind. And it's a big wake-up call. And I do feel that. And I feel like there was part of the channelings from Helen Schuckman where Jesus said that the earth has not gone through a comprehensive awakening. We're the generation. You know, I tell people I meet, I said, we're the ones. We're being called to bring about a comprehensive, exponential awakening. Not hold on to this belief system that it's just going to be this way and it's too deep and it's too dark and it's too ingrained to make a difference. You know, we're actually going through a transformation of consciousness where we're like bringing in a big wave. We're like bringing in a tsunami of love and light. And this is our generation. And even you being called to do the Course in Miracles conference down here, it's a call to joining. And I've met Kate recently. She's like, I'm on a mission. Sounds like the Blues Brothers. I'm on a mission from God. She didn't say that. She said, I'm on a mission. She wants to meet everyone who's involved in the Course around here, on this country, and way beyond that, you know, as far as the mission takes you. And it's a very strong calling. Like, we're getting activated by Christ. Not in a sense of sacrifice, not in the sense of having to give up something that we really want, but in the way of being convinced that the joy, love, light is our inheritance, and we're taking our hand up and we're saying, here I come. I'll do whatever it takes. Yeah, it's beautiful. Yes.
My question was with regard to what you spoke earlier about these therapies, hypnotherapy and all the other stuff. And, you also have your clarity process and your expression sessions to bring up and release stuff drawn from childhood and so on. What would you comment about using like EFT and Byron Katie's work? And
Oh yeah, there's just so many helpful techniques. There, like Byron Katie's work is excellent. EFT, different types of breathing techniques that involve like circular breathing. There just are so many techniques that are around that people have been discovering over the years, decades, the centuries that are helpful at looking at what was hidden or buried. So you might say what's beneath all those techniques is learning to bring the darkness to the light, is learning ways to get in touch with this unconscious darkness. And when I look at the history of religion, or even at the history of spirituality, with a lot of religions there were the do's and the don'ts, or you follow these rituals, or you believe these things. There's all these different theologies, we'll say, that are permeating all of these cultures on Earth. And oftentimes what was missing in religion was this awareness of the unconscious mind. You know, it's almost like no matter what you do on the surface to try to get out of it, until you get in touch with the darkness, until you find ways to let it come up, to allow it to come up, it's almost like you're just rearranging the deck chairs of the Titanic. You know, the ship's going to go down every scene over and over for centuries until you can get at that darkness underneath. And so, I mean, there's a number of psychologies and spiritualities that now, and there's so many great techniques that are out there for getting in touch with what was pushed out of awareness. I particularly enjoy music and movies. There's different types of worksheets, breathing techniques, just it goes on and on. There's different types of theater and acting things out, like using drama to get in touch with it. I think we could just say they're all experiential and they're all very, very helpful. And use what works for you. Something that you're drawn to, something you find engaging and even exciting, you know, is something that would be the most helpful.
Do you say that the real release of the stuff happens when there's a cathartic release, like when you do the expression sessions, and you bring up trauma, and only if there's a release, like emotional release, when there's real power in it, or is that really necessary as such?
Well, it's important to remember that all the techniques are still the spirit's use of symbols. So when people say, can I do this on my own, or do I have to do it in a group, or whatever, it's really all mind anyway. And so it's very symbolic when you are able to bring up things that you normally would not bring up, and you feel a safety and a security to be able to do that, then it's just symbolic that you really are doing that to the Holy Spirit. Because people will sometimes try to make the distinction of what's the difference between turning it over to the Spirit versus talking with others or doing these techniques. And I think the techniques and the even confession in the Catholic Church and these kind of expression sessions are all just symbolic that I don't want to hide anymore. I'm not going to stay scared and keep holding it in and stuffing it down. I'm not going to do that anymore. And so even people who take certain drugs and have a real expansive opening in their mind, it's not really the drug that did it, it's just that they felt safe enough to have that experience using a drug. And that gives them a glimpse of something that's beyond the everyday perception. That's very helpful as well. Else.
Just quickly, when you said that about the drugs, when my son a year and a half ago was in psychosis, he said some amazing stuff. I had to go, oh, that sounds reasonable, actually. Where'd you get that from? Amazing, some of the things he said. I was like, wow, that sounded wise. But he was rambling, but it made sense in a funny way. Really weird. too, even afterwards, that you remembered some of what you said.
Yeah.
I know, I got to the truth of it, and I thought, well, some of it did sound like that. It was incredible.
Yeah, it's great that you can just start to see things as witnesses to your mind and not have to label it or judge where it came from. Because I had that when I was working in vocational rehabilitation. One of my first clients, they said he was on so many different medications and he was a holy terror, and they told me all these things. I didn't listen to any of it. I just showed up and had a prayer to Jesus before it started, and then he was speaking such wisdom for the half an hour of the intake, the so-called psychotic and schizophrenic. He was speaking such wisdom and everything that after 30 minutes, I finally said, where did you learn all that?
Yeah.
He said, the Holy Spirit, of course. And so I was like, okay. That was when I was working in a voc rehab. So you start to just say, oh, this all witnesses to my mind. If I pray and I'm open and I'm not judging, then it can come in any direction and any angle, through books and movies. I have a friend of mine who, he really doesn't censor his thoughts. He really just speaks his thoughts. It's almost like this movie called The Invention of Lying, where they speak whatever's on their mind. And so his fiance is having a lot of difficulty with these thoughts that are coming up about her and so, but he's not, I said, no, I told her, I said, no, he's good, he's got Tourette's for God. Just enjoy it. It's going to be a rapid healing because he's not hiding his thoughts, he's not protecting them. And oftentimes people, they'll be in that state, judged or diagnosed as psychotic or whatever, and you can hear amazing stuff coming through.
I was surprised.
You study the course and there you go, you get that witness. Yes, Sophie.
I wondered if you could talk about the guilt that, you know, when we drop below the face of innocence into the self, when the attack turns inward, and then that sort of level of terror of the really filthy kind of guilt that's in there. And I sort of had an inkling of this feeling that you can kind of look at yourself as a separate person as well and treat Sophie as a form as well and heal it that way, to step aside a little bit from personalizing all those things that you think have happened or all that kind of stuff. And I just think, like, when you get into that level, it can feel quite difficult to see clearly, and I just wondered if you'd talk to that.
Yeah, it reminds me of the course where you go through all these chapters with Jesus, and then when you're getting into those later chapters, he's not holding back with anything. It's almost like if you think of, there's a make-believe self that's not your real self, and then you have a real self, which is your Christ self, or your purely spiritual light self. He starts describing this make-believe self as like a two-tier system. And basically, if you think of it as like a two-layered cake, that your false self has two layers. The surface layer is, he calls the face of innocence, and it's wet with tears at the injustices of the world. You know, it does a pity party, poor me. Do you see how they looked at me? And after all that I did for them, all that I've done, and they treat me this way, it's got this, this is the surfacey where all the icing is, and this is the personality self, that's all the top tier. And then there's the bottom tier. And basically, Jesus says, well, you've got like two layers of dreaming going on. You've got the dreams that you think, or your everyday interactions with the world, that's the top tier. And then there's the dreams that you dream in secret. There's the dreams that you gave away, which seems to be your everyday interactions, and then there's these dreams that are so dark and so horrific that you dream them in secret. It's like you're playing hide-and-seek with yourself, and you've got a two-tier self-concept. You don't even want to look at what's under the top layer. And So he uses three words to describe the lower tier, draped with sin. Draped, he says. Draped with sin. Dark. That the reason you made the personality self, the self that you think you are in this world, is to cover over that other self. And sometimes, even when you're going through this world, you know, like the Paul Simon song, you know, you believe you're gliding down the highway when in fact you're slip-sliding away. When you think, I'm doing pretty good, I've got my act together, I finally got my shit together, you know, I'm a whole person. I'm a whole, healed, happy person, la, 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 going along, I got it pretty good, got money in the bank account, got my insurance, got a nice house and a car, and got a good family, my relationship's never been better, I'm doing really good. That's all on the surface. And then sometimes you go to sleep at night and you have a nightmare. You know, bummer, you know. I've got my shit together during the day and there's damn nightmares. What do I have to have a nightmare for? It's they're coming out, that lower tier that is still down there and hasn't been seen beyond, hasn't been healed. It's starting to break through. And oftentimes, many people will do that. They'll try to keep their act together on the surface, and the nightmares is just showing there's something that lies beneath. There's something unresolved. And I think that's part of your question, because you're saying like you don't want to keep what's going on, the guilt, so personal. And it really isn't personal, it's just projected out into Sophie and the characters, the world around Sophie, but it's underneath there. So you might say that's why A Course in Miracles is a mind training program. And he says things in his workbook like, you know, reason you must put your care and attention into these earlier workbook lessons is because when we get to the later part of the workbook, we're going to attempt a direct approach to God. And if you haven't done your homework, if you haven't been with me and following along on these early lessons, that these later lessons are going to be more traumatic than beatific. It would almost be like if you're in university and you know, you've got your final exam, but you've really not been paying attention. You know, you haven't been taking notes, and you haven't been studying the notes, and so you're going there, and you're going into this final exam, and you're a little bit shaky because you haven't really prepared for the exam. It would be the same with spiritual awakening. That's why he's given us a mind training program, and he's given us 365 lessons, and this is the master psychologist who's saying we have to prepare because our later lessons are going to go straight beyond the words and we're going to go straight right into the heart of God. And so be ready. So to me, that's what's so great about the Course is that we are given a mind training program and he's basically only given us two instructions, too. You know, don't do more than one lesson a day and as best you can, try not to make any exceptions to the lesson. It's almost like a runway. Like, we don't expect the jetliner to just go straight up in the air. It's got to build speed in order for that wind to get underneath those giant metal wings and then for that plane to take off. You have to reach a certain speed of velocity. That's a great metaphor. And it's great to think of yourself as on the runway. You're on the runway right now, and the plane is moving. It may have just started. Sometimes we feel like, whoa, we're just barely rumbling and just starting. But as we keep practicing and practicing, our velocity gets, you know, higher and higher and higher. And then you know that feeling when the plane lifts off. You don't feel those wheels rolling on the... It's just smooth. It's a little shaky there, and up you go. And the Spirit's got you, and you just go higher and higher. That's what's happening. And just all you can do is welcome it. Like at nighttime, even before you go to sleep at night, just to say, Holy Spirit, be with me, and you know, if there's some things that are still down there that I need to look at, then let's do them here in the nighttime dream. And then when you wake up in the morning, if you feel confident, say, okay, here we go, another day. Let's see some darkness here. Bring it on. Hit me with your best shot. Come on now. If you make that prayer to the Holy Spirit, just be ready. Fire away. Pat Benatar, you know. You can click into a little Pat Benatar. But if you really are confident that you really are going to heal, this is for actual healing. This isn't for disguising or trying to fool yourself anymore. You're going down that runway and you're going to take off. And there's nothing that's going to stop you. Yeah. Yeah.
Bring it on.
Bring it on. That's the way. Here we have a new course student in the front row. And her face is all lit up. She's like, bring it on. That's the spirit. That's the yes. That's it. We can't lose. We cannot fail. It's like we're all arm in arm. Our arms are locked and we may have some stones and some gullies along the way, but we're, you know, when you're walking and you've got your mighty mates locked in arm, you're not going down.
Awesome.
You can even have a boulder that knocks both your feet and you've got your arms in there. Mighty mates got you. Here we go. Keep going. Yeah. Yeah, it's good. It's good news. Yeah, it's precious. Anyone else have anything you want to talk about today?
You talk a bit about trust.
Trust. Angie's asking about trust. Whenever I thought of trust, I always thought of faith. I think of faith and trust in the same way. And I remember talking to Jesus in the early years and just saying, that seems to be like a big key. It seems to be the key to everything, is the trust and the faith. And I would say, I just need more trust. I would always say, just need more trust, more trust, more trust. And he said, well, it's not really so much a matter of more or less. It's like, it's more a question of what are you trusting in than a more or less thing. He said, your mind is so powerful that we share the same mind, and this mind was created by God, so it's extremely powerful, but where is the trust aimed? Where is the faith aimed? And then he went into saying, look at your beliefs and look at your thoughts. Whatever you believe in, you're trusting in. And whatever you think on a daily basis, those are the thoughts that you're trusting in. And if they're looking for external solutions, things to get better, you know, in terms of worldly conditions and so on and so forth, then you're trusting in something that seems to be outside of you. And he said, I want you to trust in me. I want you to just keep that faith and trust, like I've got you. You're in the tractor beam. You're being beamed up. You cannot fail to be beamed up. You know, you are in a healing and an ascension process. And that's the key thing, is to really, what are you trusting in?
So, if I turn away from doctors, which I have, and I put my trust in the Holy Spirit, however, I'm still seeing alternative. So that means that I'm not trusting?
Well, I think when you say turn away from doctors, you're really turning away from a thought system that is based on seeing causes and consequences in the world or in the body. And so you might say, Jesus would say in the Course, that when there's too much fear to have a complete healing in mind, that occasionally there's a mixture of magic and miracles. And he's just saying that's when your mind is too fearful to make the shift completely internally. And when the mind is so terrified of that, then that's where your trust is in Jesus, your trust is in the Holy Spirit. And what you're saying is, use the symbols, use all the symbols of the world to reach me in a way that I can really recognize the solution. If I've been addicted to images, then okay, use the images to help wake me up. You've got to reach me somehow, reach me in some way. So, in one sense, I have seen people who are dealing a lot with doctors, and sometimes they would go to see a doctor and the doctor would make a diagnosis. And they would have to just be with that for a minute to say, okay, how does this feel to me, this diagnosis?
Oh, good.
And so that's sometimes where you can even hear the internal teacher say, maybe you should get a second opinion. But it's actually taking you more towards opening towards what feels helpful. So a lot of times people are told by doctors, you have this, you have this long to live, you have these conditions. It's all very much based on the body. And they open up and even can have some symbols of what's called alternative healings that can come in. For example, let's use our dear, dear friend, our brother Wayne Dyer, as an example. Wayne wrote a lot of great books, and Wayne was over there living in Hawaii not too long ago, and a friend of his said he had been diagnosed by the medical profession as having cancer. And so he was trying to modify his diet a bit and do exercise. He was doing the magical things that oftentimes some doctors will say could be helpful and everything. But a friend of his contacted him and said, oh, I am going to see John of God down in Brazil, and I'm going to ask him to pray for you and find a treatment for your condition. And Wayne was not too impressed by this and continued on doing his things. And then basically this woman, a friend of his, said, oh, I've got you an appointment for some psychic surgery on such and such a day. And again, Wayne was not too impressed. Okay, psychic surgery and this. She said, yes, you'll have to be resting, and you shouldn't be eating before the psychic surgery, and gave him all the things that he should do. And basically he ignored it, and he went out for his jog along the beach and everything during the time of the psychic surgery, until he was hit so hard he could hardly walk. He didn't really follow the advice, but when he came back, you know, he started to go, maybe there's something to this psychic surgery. And actually, he did go into remission from the cancer, from his friend just saying, here, I'm doing this for you. I'm getting a gift for you to help you out. Now, even the psychic surgery still involves some magic. You know, as if there's someone in Brazil praying for you and you have to do these procedures and everything. But he pretty much succumbed to join with his dear friend who was offering this help, and then the symptoms went away. So it's the spirit of joining, it's the spirit of open-mindedness, it's the spirit of, even with all those books he'd done and all those workshops and seminars and whatever, it was just a great symbol to me of Wayne going, okay, maybe I maybe I don't have all the answers here. A similar thing happened to Ram Dass, you know, when he had his stroke. You know, when he had his stroke, he's there looking up at the tiles on the ceiling going, look at this. Mr. God's having a stroke. That's what he thought. Imagine how, here's Ram Dass, you know, he's been at it for years and everything, and he's laying there having a stroke going, Mr. God's having a stroke. You know, be here now. Okay, let's be here now. Look at, oh, my God, I got a stroke going on here. And then, but that didn't stop him. That didn't stop him, you know, that he got more humble through that stroke because he turned to spirit, because he said, no, this isn't the end of me. This is the beginning of another phase of healing. That is humbleness. It doesn't matter how many books you've written, it doesn't matter how many seminars you've done, no matter how much success you've had in the world, we're here to be humbled in the presence of God's healing power and to humbly open up. And I think that's what's really going on, is that every day you're just coming into that humbleness of show me, show me.
So I've chosen to live in the present. I've chosen to know everything that I've been told. And however, as I said, trust. That's what I wanted you to talk about, trust. There's that voice sometimes that comes in. Send it away. Just try to live in the moment. The moment's pretty good. The moment is amazing. I'm pretty much in love with me and God. And I feel that I handed everything over to God. I chose not to talk about it. Chose not to tell any, only a handful of people. That's it. Is that the ego, or is that?
Well, to be even coming here tonight, and you said you and Star are going on this trip. You're on an adventure. You are on an adventure, day by day, moment by moment. And, you know, a good name for your trip, your adventure, might be the Show Me. This could be your Show Me trip. All, that's where that's what you're putting your trust in. You're putting your trust in Show Me. Show Me, lead the way. Every day, let the symbols come that are representing you, God. Every day, let the symbols of hope, of comfort, of calmness come to me, and you show me. And it's great, you know, to keep it that simple.
Well, that's what I'm doing. We haven't been on a trip for 12 months. That's not like us.
I think that, I remember you, you made a trip over to see me in the big island of Hawaii. That was a pretty big voyage too. Yeah. And that was wonderful too, because we came into contact, and then you've been listening to the words I'm speaking and letting them bring comfort and the lightness and a blessing. That's your therapy. That's what you're choosing.
Mine have disturbed my peace the other day because you were talking and then we had that heavy rain and I couldn't hear you.
I couldn't hear me. It was pounding the roof so
hard. So, yeah, it was good.
Yeah. Yes.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Just in relation to what you've been saying, that when it comes to medications and things like that, little story that happened to me, probably close to 2 years now, not quite. I had a condition which I was told was incurable, and I'd had medications and things, and nothing was working. And there was one treatment that right in the very beginning when I found out I had this condition, I was told, do not do this treatment. It will make it worse. It doesn't work. So I avoided it for 5 years or so and got to a point nearly 2 years ago where I just couldn't live with this anymore, and it was just, my life was just so, it was affecting me so badly that I just, either it was going to get cured or I wanted to die. So I prayed about it, and then I read a particular short paragraph in one of Gary Renard's books that said something to the effect of, sometimes a healing, we can be healed, but often our minds or our egos, it's too confronting for a miracle healing. So often you need something to hang your miracle on, a treatment or something that you can hang it on. So I thought, this is the last thing I've got left to try, is this treatment that I was told not to do. And I prayed, and I brought Holy Spirit in, and I just completely thought, well, this is it. I'm going to try it, and this will be my miracle. And I really sort of virtually just washed myself with that every day. This is going to be my miracle. This is going to be my healing for a few weeks. And then when the treatment came up, it was a treatment over 4 months, and each week I had to have this treatment, which was very painful. I had my first treatment, and it was very painful, and I went about three days of pain, and then the fourth day, which happened to be my birthday, I woke up pain-free, and I had pain-free for the next 3 days or so till the next treatment. I went and had the second treatment, and the nurse was, well, how did you survive the week? It must have been terrible. And I said, well, first 3 days was, but then I had no pain. And she said, that's not possible. You don't get cured that quick. I said, well, it happened. I decided to have a miracle. She said, well, you're not. She said, it is. Because it usually takes quite a few treatments before anything even starts to get better. So each week I had the treatment, the pain would be shorter and shorter. Like instead of 3 or 4 days, it would be two and a half. So each time it got shorter and shorter until it got only half an hour after each treatment. And now I'm fine. I believe that I've been healed, because I haven't had any problems at all since the end of that treatment. So I hung my hat on that cure, so it's like the symbol, one of the symbols that I was told wasn't going to work, but I said, no, I have faith in my higher power and that this is going to work. And I don't know, how do you describe that? That's what happened.
Yeah, I think there's something inside of us that knows that healing has to be simple. And I think the simplest thing you can do when you have all these beliefs about bodies and symptoms and different systems of the body and how they all work together and everything like this, is come down in your mind to the idea that every second of every day I'm deciding between grievances and miracles. And we'll say the grievances are the sickness and the miracle is the healing. Every second of every day. All that other stuff is a bunch of fluff. It's to try to make things more complicated than every day, every second of every day is grievances or miracles. And again, you come back into those great workbook lessons. My grievances hide the light of the world in me. So wow, if I've even got subtle grievances, those are hiding the light of the world in me. Those are hiding the healing from me. So, in one sense, remember that old fairy tale, the princess and the pea, you know, where the pea's under all the mattresses? That's what we're, in one sense, there's something rose up in you, it's like, I'm going for the miracle. In some way, in the mind, it's like, I'm going to decide for the miracle. And that's that adventure you're on. It's not really an adventure in time and space, even though it seems you'll get to do some traveling, you both meet people and see some sights and everything. That's just the backdrop. But every day, if there's even the niggling of of a grievance. Even somebody, when they cross your mind, you don't think of them with supreme joy and happiness. You can be like a sleuth and go, ah, I see there's a grievance there. Even the slightest bit of irritation or annoyance at something gives you an opportunity to choose again for the miracle. So to me, that's very practical, because the ego wants to keep it really complicated, buried under layers and layers of complication, when actually we're choosing between miracles and grievances all the time. And it's helpful when Jesus says there's no difference between minor irritation and annoyance and intense rage. You see, he's not a big fan of degrees of upset. Upset is upset, and upset is a grievance. And we're worth it. Maybe people say, well, you have to go through your mind with a fine-tooth comb. Okay, let's be about it, you know, because I'm worth it. Why am I worth it? Because I'm a child of God. I was created by God. I'm worth it. I'm worth the mind training. I'm worth noticing a scrap here or a scrap there and say, oh, be gone. I'm not going to hold on to that. I tell the story, I think we're getting to the point of closure here, but I'll tell my final story. I worked at hospice. I had to train to go through years of, it was probably, before I was out on the floor, I had to go through at least like a couple months, I think, of training. And I was in the middle of my training for hospice, and there was a minister that was in there, and he said, let's go out to Wendy's. And so we went out to have a burger, and we're sitting talking and everything, and he looked across at me and he said, I've been diagnosed with leukemia, and it's pretty far advanced, so I don't know how many more weeks I can continue on with the hospice training. And we sat there having our Wendy's burger and our fries and everything, and finally I looked at him and I said to him, is there somebody in your life that used to be really close to you, and you used to just talk and laugh, and they were so close to you, but you haven't spoken to them in years? And he stood back and he put his hamburger down and he said, how did you know about my sister? And I said, so you haven't spoken to your sister in years. And I said, you know what? This leukemia diagnosis that you've got, it's not what you think it is. You've got a grievance against your sister, and you need to go home. Here's your homework for the hospice homework for the night. You need to go home and bury the hatchet. You need to go and call her and talk to her from your heart, because you love her. It's been the craziest thing that you haven't spoken. How did it ever get into that? And he's like, you're right, it is crazy, it's just absolutely crazy. But he had not made the connection between the grievance with his sister and the leukemia. And so I didn't see him for a couple weeks, but when I saw him the next time, he had gone in and they had searched with their x-rays and everything, they couldn't find a trace of leukemia, because he had gone through that opening of his heart with his sister. And he did bury the hatchet, he did let go, and he did tell me it was so silly what he was holding on to. And so to me, that's what we're doing, is we're allowing ourselves to make the connections in our mind, like, wow, it's important for me to be free of grievances. What does that even mean? It means that anyone from your entire life could show up in your life, and you could sit there, you could look them in the eye, you could smile at them, you could give them a big long hug, you could love them without any sense of animosity, any sense of wrongdoing, any sense of even irritation and annoyance. They could come right back into your life and you could embrace them. That's a miracle. That's a practical miracle of doing that. And really, that's what we're doing with everything in our life, where you could just have somebody show right up in your life again. And Jesus says, dream softly of your sinless brother. remember all the helpfulness that he gave instead of the hurts. He has a beautiful little meditation there in the Course. Dream softly of your sinless brother. He only offered you love, but you were mistaken when you saw a grievance, when you saw something that was wounded in yourself that you wanted to throw out onto your brother or sister instead of throwing it back at the Holy Spirit and saying, here, take this. I don't need this grudge anymore. That's the most practical medicine that we could ever have. And then, of course, there's many doctors and, you know, I think of my friend Bernie Siegel, a Facebook friend of mine, he was a surgeon right smack dab in the middle of the medical model, and he just got into prayer. And he started to see so many healings, and he got so into it that where he worked, people used to make jokes about him and put them up on the bulletin boards about the wacko prayer doctor that they've got in the middle of them. Eventually, of course, he left the whole medical profession behind. He, I don't need these kind of friends and these kind of witnesses every day. I'm going for prayer. He went on, and him and his wife went around. He wrote books, Love, Medicine, and Miracles. He used everything that he had learned, but to talk about the power of prayer and the power of the mind. And he went out on the lecture circuit and he wrote many, many books, and he cast aside his surgery days because they no longer served him anymore. They were just concepts that he could use in his talks. He didn't have to go cutting into flesh anymore. He could use the power of prayer. That's the inspiration. That's what we're all called to be. We're called to be miracle workers, and the Spirit can use everything that we learned in our life. We don't have to, you know, try to go out and get a new set of tools. We got plenty of tools already. Well, I said I'd talk for 2 hours, so I've already gone over. Some of you have other plans on this happy, sunny day. So, hope I can just give you all hugs and spend a little time with you all before you take off for the day. But thank you so much for having me here. And Tia and James, thank you for organizing this beautiful place. And we'll go back to your living room and have some tea. Thank you. Blessings. Thank you. Love you. Beautiful.